The sharing of biased and false news has become all too common on social media. More alarming, some media outlets publish the same fake stories without checking facts first.
The sharing of biased and false news has become all too common on social media.
More alarming, some media
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
You were both in Skull and Bone, the secret society.
It's so secret we can't talk about it.
What does that mean for America? The conspiracy theorists are going to go wild.
I'm sure they are. I don't know. I haven't seen the website.
Number 322?
First of all, he's not the nominee.
Are you prepared to lose?
No, I'm not going to lose.
Since World War II, America has encouraged and benefited from the global advance of free markets, from the strength of democratic alliances, and from the advance of free societies. At one level, this has been a raw calculation of interest. The 20th century features some of the worst horrors of history because dictators committed them.
If this were a dictatorship, it'd be a heck of a lot easier. Just so long as I'm the dictator.
And we know that when we lose sight of our ideals, it is not democracy that has failed.
We haven't seen this kind of barbarism in a long period of time. No one could have conceivably imagined suicide bombers burrowing into our society and then emerging all on the same day to fly their aircraft, fly U.S. aircraft, into buildings full of innocent people and show no remorse.
And we know that when we lose sight of our ideals, it is not democracy that has failed. It is the failure of those charged with preserving and protecting democracy.
And this is a new kind of evil. And we understand. And the American people are beginning to understand. This crusade. This war on terrorism is going to take a while.
This is not to underestimate the historical obstacles to the development of democratic institutions and a democratic culture.
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
This is not to underestimate the historical obstacles to the development of democratic institutions and a democratic culture.
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
Such problems nearly destroyed our country. And that should encourage a spirit of humility and a patience with others. Freedom is not merely a political menu option or a foreign policy fad. It should be the defining commitment of our country and the hope of the world. That appeal is proved not just by the content of people's hopes, but a noteworthy hypocrisy. That appeal is proved not just by the content of people's hopes, but a noteworthy hypocrisy. No democracy pretends to be a tyranny. Most tyrannies pretend they are democracies. Democracy remains the definition of political legitimacy. That has not changed, and that will not change. That appeal is proved not just by the content of people's hopes, but a noteworthy hypocrisy.
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
That appeal is proved not just by the content of people's hopes, but a noteworthy hypocrisy.
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
A noteworthy hypocrisy.
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
That appeal is proved not just by the content of people's hopes, but a noteworthy hypocrisy.
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
A noteworthy hypocrisy.
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
In my line of work, you got to keep repeating things over and over and over again for the truth to sink in, to kind of catapult the propaganda.
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
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 There's gorillas in the street. Everyone you meet, everywhere you look is a gorilla. Gorillas in the back. Gorillas driving tanks. Gorillas out in space. Gorillas in your face. Gorillas in your house, running all about. Everywhere you look is a gorilla. Your brother's a gorilla. Your sister's a gorilla. Your bunch of both gorillas. You are a gorilla. Gorillas wearing suits. Gorillas in pursuits. Everywhere you look, you see gorillas. Who deserves a rage? Who deserves the cage? The animal within you. You are a gorilla.
Yet for years, challenges have been gathering to the principles we hold dear. And we must take them seriously. Some of these problems are external and obvious. Here in New York City, you know the threat of terrorism all too well.
Gorillas sailing ships, gorillas taking trips. Everywhere you look, you see gorillas. They sit there in their chairs, they're walking up the stairs, they're riding in their cars. Gorilla movie stars, gorillas in the news, they even play the blues. Everywhere you look, you see gorillas. Behind the cash machines, selling gasoline. Gorillas in the house, gorillas all about.
It's being fought even now on distant frontiers, and in the hidden world of intelligence and surveillance. There is the frightening, evolving threat of nuclear proliferation and outlaw regimes. There's an aggressive challenge by Russia and China to the norms and rules of global order.
There's gorillas in the street, everyone you meet. Everywhere you look is a gorilla. Gorillas in the back, gorillas driving tanks. Gorillas out in space, gorillas in your face. Gorillas in your house, running all about. Everywhere you look is a gorilla. Your brother's a gorilla, your sister's a gorilla. Your folks are both gorillas, you are a gorilla.
They propose revisions that always seem to involve less respect for the rights of free nations and less freedom for the individual. These matters would be difficult under any circumstances. They are further complicated by a trend in Western countries away from global engagement and democratic confidence. Parts of Europe have developed an identity crisis. We have seen insolvency, economic stagnation, youth unemployment, anger about immigration, resurgent ethno-nationalism, and deep questions about the meaning and durability of the European Union. America is not immune from these trends. In recent decades, public confidence in our institutions has declined. Our governing class has often been paralyzed. The American dream of upward mobility seems out of reach for some who feel left behind in a changing economy. Bigotry seems emboldened. Our politics seems more vulnerable to conspiracy theories and outright fabrication.
You both were members of Skull and Bones, a secret society at Yale. What does that tell us?
Not much, because it's a secret.
Is there a secret handshake? Is there a secret code?
I wish there were something secret I could manifest.
322, a secret number?
There are all kinds of secrets.
Mr. President, this is the first head of state, Pope Benedict XVI, that you will ever greet on a tarmac. I was stunned to learn this. Why are you going and greeting him at an airstrip? Usually, the heads of states come here.
Because he is a really important figure in a lot of ways. One, he speaks for millions. Two, he doesn't come as a politician. He comes as a man of faith. And three, that I so subscribe to his notion that there's right and wrong in life, that that moral relativism has the danger of undermining the capacity to have more hopeful and free societies, that I'd want to honor his convictions as well.
You read his book on Europe, I'm told. What do you take generally from his appraisal of Europe and the world, and why is this relationship between the United States and the Holy See so important to you?
Well, first of all, it's important to me because the Holy Father represents and stands for some values that I think are important for the health of the country.
Why is this relationship between the United States and the Holy See so important to you?
Well, first of all, it's important to me because the Holy Father represents and stands for some values that I think are important for the health of the country. And when he comes to America, millions of my fellow citizens will be hanging on his every word. I do know that in order for a president to be effective, he better bring a set of principles from which he will not deviate and articulate them as clearly as he can, and then not worry about, immediate popularity, because popularity comes and goes, but what doesn't change are solid principles. And I'm going to remind his Holy Father how important his voice is in making it easier for politicians like me to be able to kind of stand and defend our positions that are, I think, very important positions to take.
Mr. President, final question.
Yes, sir.
You said famously, when you looked into Vladimir Putin's eyes, you saw his soul.
Yeah.
When you look into Benedict XVI's eyes, what do you see?
God.
A proud look, a lying tongue and hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, feet that be swift in running to mischief, a false witness that speaketh lies, and he that soweth discord among brethren. My son, keep thy father's commandment, and forsake not the law of thy mother. Bind them continually upon thine heart, and tie them about thy neck. When thou goest, it shall lead thee. When thou sleepest, it shall keep thee. When thou awakest, it shall talk with thee. For the commandment is a lamp, and the law is light, and reproofs of instruction are the way of life, to keep thee from the evil woman, from the flattery of the tongue of a strange woman. Lust not after her beauty in thine heart, neither let her take thee with her eyelids. For by means of a whorish woman, a man is brought to a piece of bread, and the adulteress will hunt for the precious life. Can a man take fire in his bosom and his clothes not be burned? Can one go upon hot coals and his feet not be burned? So he that goeth into his neighbor's wife, whosoever toucheth her shall not be innocent. Men do not despise a thief, if he steal to satisfy his soul when he is hungry. But if he be found, he shall restore sevenfold. He shall give all the substance of his house. But whoso committeth adultery with a woman lacketh understanding. He that doeth it destroyeth his own soul. A wound and dishonor shall he get, and his reproach shall not be wiped away. For jealousy is the rage of a man. Therefore, he will not spare in the day of vengeance. He will not regard any ransom, neither will he rest content, though thou givest many gifts. My son, keep my words and lay up my commandments with thee. Keep my commandments and live, and my law as the apple of thine eye. Bind them upon thy fingers, write them upon the table of thine heart. Say unto wisdom, thou art my sister, and call understanding thy kinswoman, that they may keep thee from the strange woman, from the stranger which flattereth with her words. For at the window of my house I looked through my casement, and beheld among the simple ones I discerned the youths, a young man void of understanding, passing through the streets near her corner, and he went the way to her house in the twilight, in the evening, in the black and dark night. And behold, there met him a woman with the attire of a harlot and subtle of heart. She is loud and stubborn. Her feet abide not in her house. Now is she without, now in the streets, and lieth in wait at every corner. So she caught him, and kissed him, and with an imprudent face said unto him, I have peace offerings with me. This day I have paid my vows. Therefore came I forth to meet thy face, diligently to seek thy face, and I have found thee. I have decked my bed with coverings of tapestry, with carved works, and with fine linen of Egypt. I have perfumed my bed with myrrh, aloes, and cinnamon. Come, let us take our fill of love till the morning. Let us solace ourselves with loves, for the goodman is not at home. He is gone a long journey, and he taketh a bag of money with him, and will come home at the day appointed. With her much fair speech she caused him to yield, with the flattering of her lips she forced him. He goeth after her straightway, as an ox goeth to the slaughter, or as a fool to the correction of the stocks, till a dart strike through his liver, as a bird hasteth to the snare, and knoweth not that it is for his life. Hearken unto me now, therefore, O ye children, and attend to the words of my mouth. Let not thine heart decline to her ways, go not astray in her paths. For she hath cast down many wounded, yea, many strong men have been slain by her. Her house is the way to hell, going down to the chambers of death. The history of Protestantism, which we propose to write, is no mere history of dogmas. The teachings of Christ are the seeds. The modern Christendom, with its new life, is the godly tree which has sprung from them. We shall speak of the seed and then of the tree, so small at its beginning, but destined one day to cover the earth. How that seed was deposited in the soil, how the tree grew up and flourished despite the furious tempests that warred around it. How century after century it lifted its top higher in heaven and spread its burrows wider around, sheltering liberty, nursing letters, fostering art, and gathering a fraternity of prosperous and powerful nations around it. It will be our business in the following pages to show. Meanwhile, we wish it to be noted that this is what we understand by the Protestantism on the history of which we are now entering. Viewed thus, and any narrower view would be untrue alike to philosophy and to fact. The history of Protestantism is the record of one of the greatest dramas of all time. It is true, no doubt, that Protestantism, strictly viewed, is simply a principle. It is not a policy. It is not an empire having its fleets and armies, its officers and tribunals, wherewith to extend its dominion and make its authority obeyed. It is not even a church with its hierarchies and synods and edicts. It is simply a principle. But it is the greatest of all principles. It is a creative power. Its plastic influence is all-embracing. It penetrates into the heart and renews the individual. It goes down to the depths and, by its omnipotent but noiseless energy, vivifies and regenerates society. It thus becomes the creator of all that is true and lovely and great, the founder of free kingdoms, and the mother of pure churches. The globe itself, it claims, as a stage, not too wide for the manifestation of its beneficent action, and the whole dominion of terrestrial affairs, it deems a sphere not too vast to fill with its spirit and rule by its law. Whence came this principle? The name Protestantism is very recent. The thing itself is very ancient. The term Protestantism is scarcely older than 500 years. It dates from the protest which the Lutheran princes gave in the Diet of Spires in 1529. Restricted to its historical signification, Protestantism is purely negative. It only defines the attitude taken up at a great historical era by one party in Christendom with reference to another party. But had this been all, Protestantism would have had no history. Had it been purely negative, it would have begun and ended with the men who assembled at the German town in the year already specified. The new world that has come out of it is the proof that at the bottom of this protest was a great principle which it has pleased Providence to fertilize and make the seed of those grand, beneficent, and enduring achievements which have made the past five centuries, in many respects, the most eventful and wonderful in history. The men who handed in this protest did not wish to create a mere void. If they disowned the creed and threw off the yoke of Rome, it was that they might plant a purer faith and restore the government of a higher law. They replaced the authority of the infallibility with the authority of the Word of God. The long and dismal obscuration of centuries they dispelled, that the twin stars of liberty and knowledge might shine forth, and that conscience being unbound, the intellect might awake from its deep solemnity, and human society, renewing its youth, might, after its halt of 1,000 years, resume its march towards its high goal. We repeat the question, whence came this principle? And we ask our readers to mark well the answer, for it is the keynote to the whole of our vast subject and places us at the very outset, at the very springs of that long narration on which we are now entering. Protestantism is not solely the outcome of human progress. It is no mere principle of perfectibility inherent in humanity and ranking as one of its native powers, in virtue of which, when society becomes corrupt, it can purify itself, and when it is arrested in its course by some external force or stops from exhaustion, it can recruit its energy and set forward anew on its path. It is neither the product of an individual reason, nor the result of a joint thought and energies of the species. Protestantism is a principle which has its origin outside human society. It is a divine graft on the intellectual and moral nature of man, whereby new vitalities and forces are introduced into it, and the human stem yields henceforth a nobler fruit. It is the descent of a heaven-born influence which allies itself with all the instincts and powers of the individual, with all the laws and cravings of society, and which, both quickening the individual and the social being into new life, and directing their efforts to nobler objects, permits the highest development of which humanity is capable, and the fullest possible accomplishment of all its grand ends. In a word, Protestantism is revived Christianity.
Pope's address had a gentle bite, urging an end to toxic politics, but appealing to the best of America.
In the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Minnesota Democratic Senator Amy Klobuchar was part of a small delegation serving as the Pope's escort, meeting briefly with Francis, who blessed them.
And just to be that close to him, people often say that you kind of feel this grace and wisdom, and that was true.
Democratic Representative Keith Ellison, the first Muslim congressman, said the Pope's call to action went beyond religion or politics.
He didn't mention a piece of legislation or even a policy or even a candidate. What he talked about are core values, in my view, and he left it up to us to work those things out.
The Pope's wide-ranging remarks could be considered political, but Republican Tom Emmer, a Catholic, said they were anything but.
In between the lines, what I heard was, regardless of your political persuasion, America has an important place in the world, and you're going to have to lead.
Klobuchar's papal visit guest was Timothy Marks, the president of Catholic Charities in Minnesota. He called the emotion in the room overwhelming as the Pope stood with lawmakers under the carving, "In God We Trust."
Which really says we are all one. Our faith, our politics, our personalities mixed together, and we all have an obligation to use the tools and gifts that we have to advance the common good.
leaders of faith in public life across this country and across the world. To my brothers and sisters in Christ. I often say, when people have asked me over the years what my philosophy is, I tell them I'm a Christian, a conservative, and a Republican. We gather today on the eve of a historic anniversary to celebrate what happened here, in this very hall, 70 years ago, when the United Nations declared to the modern world an ancient truth, that the Jewish people have a natural, irrevocable right to an independent state in their ancestral and eternal homeland.
Mr. Speaker, in these uncertain days, it's important that we cling to the permanent things and the ancient truths. Among them is the principle that fear is useless. What is needed is trust. As we prepare in the next hour to vote on H.R. 2975, the Patriot Act of 2001, I rise as a proud member of the House Judiciary Committee to say this legislation is about trust. It is not about fear.
The ceremony of induction of the Jesuit is in the Library of Congress in the card is 6643354. It's an unbelievable admission to the world of what goes on in the initiation of a Jesuit into the profess. The Jesuit order, my son, you have been taught to act a dissembler among the Roman Catholics, to be a Roman Catholic, and to be a spy even among your own brethren, to believe no man, to trust no man, among the Reformers to be a Reformer, among the Huguenots to be a Huguenot, among the Calvinists to be a Calvinist, among the Protestants generally, be a Protestant. And obtaining their confidence to speak, to seek to speak from their pulpits, and to denounce with all vehemence in your nature our holy religion and the Pope, and even to descend so low as to become a Jew among the Jews, that you might be enabled to gather together all information for the benefit of your order as a faithful soldier of the Pope. You have been taught to insidiously plant the seeds of jealousy and hatred between states that were at peace and incite them to deeds of blood involving them in war with each other and to create revolutions and civil wars in communities, provinces, and countries that were independent and prosperous, cultivating the arts and the sciences, enjoying the blessing of peace. To take sides with the combatants and to act secretly in concert with your brother Jesuit, who might be engaged on the other side, but openly opposed to that with which you might be connected. Only that the church might be the gainer in the end and the condition fixed in the treaties for peace, and that the end justifies the means.
Francis Rooney of Florida earlier this week taking the criticism, shall we say, to a new level.
We're saying that we don't like what we've seen out of Strozak and Orr and some of the behaviors that they exhibited, which were kind of ends justifies the means behavior.
Francis Rooney of Florida.
We're saying that we don't like what we've seen out of Strozak and Orr and some of the behaviors that they exhibited, which were kind of ends justifies the means behavior to try to discredit President Trump's campaign during the campaign. And we got to get to the bottom of that.
You have been taught your duties as a spy to gather all statistics, facts, and information in your power from every source. To ingratiate yourself into the confidence of the family circle of the Protestants and heretics of every class and character, as well as that of the merchant, the banker, the lawyer, among the schools and universities, in parliaments and legislatures, and in the judiciaries and councils of state, and to be all things to all men for the Pope's sake, whose servants we are unto death. You've received all your instructions heretofore as a novice, a neophyte, and have served as a coadjutor, confessor, and priest. But you have not yet been invested with all that is necessary to command in the army of Loyola in the service of the Pope. You must serve the proper time as the instrument and executioner, as directed by your superiors. For none can command here who has not consecrated his labor with the blood of the heretic. For without the shedding of blood, no man can be saved. Therefore, to fit yourself for your work and make your own salvation sure, you will, in addition to your former oath of obedience to your order and allegiance to the Pope, repeat after me. I promise and declare that I will, when opportunity presents, make and wage relentless war, secretly or openly, against all heretics, Protestants, liberals, as I am directed to do, to extirpate and exterminate them from the face of the whole earth, and that I will spare neither age, sex, condition, and that I will hang, burn, waste, boil, flay, strangle, bury alive these infamous heretics, rip up the stomachs and wombs of their women and crush their infants' heads against the walls in order to annihilate forever their execrable race, that when the same cannot be done openly, I will secretly use the poison cup, the strangulating cord, the steel of the pinyard, or the leaden bullet, regardless of honor, rank, dignity, or authority of the person or persons, whatever they may be their condition in life, either public or private, as I, at any time, may be directed so to do by any agent of the Pope or superior of the Brotherhood of the Holy Faith, the Society of Jesus.
We're saying that we don't like what we've seen out of Strozak and Orr and some of the behaviors that they exhibited, which were kind of ends justifies the means behavior to try to discredit the President Trump's campaign during the campaign. And we got to get to the bottom of that.
Mr. Speaker, in these uncertain days, it's important that we cling to the permanent things and the ancient truths. Among them is the principle that fear is useless. What is needed is trust. I rise as a proud member of the House Judiciary Committee to say this legislation is about trust. It is not about fear. It is about trusting the law enforcement authorities of this country with the powers, some temporary, some permanent, to stop those who would wage war on our citizens before they level the attacks. We do not bring this legislation to this floor in fear. We bring this legislation to the floor in trust. We trust in God. We trust in the governing authorities that our God has placed for such a time as this. I urge all of my colleagues to join me in strongly supporting the Patriot Act of 2001.
Simply put, this country and this world benefit from your commitment to Jesuit principles, to being men and women for others.
Forsaking God, give us a king. And it came to pass, when Samuel was old, that he made his sons judges over Israel. Now the name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second Abiah, and they were judges in Beersheba. And the sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre, and took bribes, and perverted judgment. Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together, and came to Samuel unto Ramah, and said unto him, Behold, thou art old, and thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, Give us a king to judge us. And Samuel prayed unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Samuel, Hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee, for they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them, according to all the works which they have done since the day that I brought them out of Egypt, even unto this day, wherewith they have forsaken me and served other gods, so do they also unto thee. Now therefore hearken unto their voice, howbeit yet protest solemnly unto them, and show them the manner of the king that shall reign over them. And Samuel told all the words of the Lord unto the people that asked of him a king. And he said, This will be the manner of the king that shall reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them for himself, for his chariots, and to be his horsemen, and some shall run before his chariots. And he will appoint him captains over thousands, and captains over fifties, and will set them to ear his ground. and to reap his harvest, and to make his instruments of war and instruments of his chariots. He will take your daughters to be confectionaries and to be cooks and to be bakers. And he will take your fields and your vineyards and your olive yards, even the best of them, and give them to his servants. And he will take the tenth of your seed and of your vineyard and give to his officers and to his servants. And he will take your men servants and your maid servants and your godliest young men and your asses and put them to his work. He will take the tenth of your sheep, and ye shall be his servants. And ye shall cry out in that day because of your king which he shall have chosen you, and the Lord will not hear you in that day. Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel, and they said, Nay, but we will have a king over us, that we may also be like all the nations, and that our king may judge us, and go out before us, and fight our battles. And Samuel heard all the words of the people, and he rehearsed them in the ears of the Lord. And the Lord said to Samuel, Hearken unto their voice, and make them a king. And Samuel said unto the men of Israel, Go ye every man unto his city.
For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God, it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and base things of the world and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according as it is written, He that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom, which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. Which things also we speak not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. For who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. Let no man deceive himself. If any man among you seemeth to be wise in this world, let him become a fool, that he may be wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he taketh the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knoweth the thoughts of the wise, that they are vain. Therefore let no man glory in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, or the world or life or death or things present or things to come, all are yours, and ye are Christ's, and Christ is God's.